This episode is brought to you by Skillshare. The first 1,000 people to sign up using the link in the description will get their first 2 months free. Nuclear reactors are not pieces of equipment you come across every day. They're designed to produce thermal energy that can be used for its own sake or converted into mechanical energy, and most of the time, into electrical energy. They work by maintaining a chain reaction producing a steady flow of neutrons, generated by the fission of heavy nuclei, the most common of which is uranium-235 that produces the thermal heat. There are many different types of nuclear power reactors, but you certainly can't shop for one online. However, there was one kid who was determined to get his hands on a reactor for himself. Welcome to this episode of the Infographic Show, the Boy Scout who tried to build a nuclear reactor. Imagine opening your bedroom curtains one day and looking out of your window to see a strange green glow resonating from your neighbor's shed, and then noticing government trucks being loaded with barrels marked radioactive by men dressed in hazmat suits outside your home. You might think you had been transported onto the set of the latest Hollywood sci-fi blockbuster. But in 1995, for the residents of Gulf Manor, Michigan, this was no made-for-TV drama. A young teenage boy had built a nuclear breeder reactor in his mother's potting shed, a crazy idea he thought up while working on his Atomic Energy Merit Badge in an attempt to earn Eagle Scout status. The boy's name was David Charles Hahn, who, not surprisingly, is sometimes called the Radioactive Boy Scout or the Nuclear Boy Scout. So how did teenager David Hahn go from being an everyday goofy schoolboy to nuclear reactor developer? Ken Silverstein is an American journalist who used to be the Washington editor and blogger at Harper's Magazine. He met David in the late 90s to try and figure out exactly what happened by hearing the story from the proverbial horse's mouth. He described David as oddly dispassionate, though polite, until they began to discuss his nuclear adventures. Then, for 5 hours, David became enthused as he talked about working in his backyard laboratory. He explained to Silverstein that he used coffee filters and pickle jars to handle deadly substances such as radium and nitric acid whilst working on developing his reactor. David was a shy teenager and so had only confided in a few friends about his crazy and ambitious project, but never allowed anyone to witness his experiments. He said to Silverstein, "I was very emotional as a kid, and those experiments gave me a way to get away from that. They gave me some respect." As David became more and more preoccupied with science, he had less and less time for friends, though during his high school years, he did have a girlfriend, Heather Baudet. Heather was 3 years younger than David, and she says he was sweet and caring, but not always the perfect date. Heather's mom described David this way: "He was a nice kid and always presentable, but we had to tell him not to talk to anybody. He could eat and drink, but for God's sakes, don't talk to the guests about the food's chemical composition." But how did David advance from being this somewhat geeky experimenting student to a boy with a reactor? David was a Boy Scout, and Eagle Scouts must earn 21 merit badges. 11 are mandatory, such as first aid and citizenship in the community. The final 10 are optional, and Scouts can choose from dozens of choices ranging from American business to woodwork. Of course, David chose to specialize and earn a merit badge in atomic energy. He was awarded his Atomic Energy Merit Badge on May 10, 1991, 5 months shy of his 15th birthday. To earn the badge, David visited a hospital radiology unit to learn about the medical uses of radioisotopes. He made a drawing showing how nuclear fission occurs, but most importantly, David built a model reactor using simple household apparatus, including a juice can, coat hangers, soda straws, matches, and rubber bands. The Scouts were impressed, but David had far greater ambitions. He got to work with writing as many as 20 letters a day, pretending to be a physics instructor at Chippewa Valley High School. This budding young entrepreneur approached groups in his merit badge pamphlet, such as the DOE, the Nuclear Regulatory Commission, or NRC, the American Nuclear Society, the Edison Electric Institute, and the Atomic Industrial Forum, the Nuclear Power Industries Trade Group. He obtained all sorts of information. The NRC was by far the most helpful, and David managed to engage the agency's Director of Isotope Production and Distribution, Donald Erb. Erb provided tips on isolating certain radioactive elements. He gave a list of isotopes that can sustain a chain reaction and imparted a piece of information that would soon prove to be vital to David's plans. Nothing produces neutrons as well as beryllium. The NRC had now given David all the information he required to build a reactor, and he just needed to source the raw materials. He typed up a shopping list of items that contained very small amounts of the 14 radioactive isotopes required for the first step. Americium-241, he discovered, could be found in smoke detectors, radium-226 in antique luminous dial clocks, uranium-238, and minute quantities of uranium-235, in a black ore called Pitch Blend, and thorium-232 in Coleman-style gas lanterns. David created a neutron gun and was ready to irradiate. He thought that uranium-235, which is used in atomic weapons, would provide the biggest reaction, but getting your hands on uranium is no simple task. He hunted hundreds of miles of Upper Michigan looking for hot rocks with his Geiger counter, but all he could find was a quarter trunkload of Pitch Blend, a radioactive uranium-rich mineral on the shores of Lake Huron. He also posed as a professor again, buying materials for a nuclear research laboratory. He obtained a few samples, but not enough. He eventually decided to switch from uranium and instead hunt down some thorium-232, which, when bombarded with neutrons, produces uranium-233. David knew from his merit badge Boy Scout pamphlet that the mantle used in commercial gas lanterns is coated with a compound containing thorium-232. He bought thousands of lantern mantles from surplus stores and, using a blowtorch, reduced them into a pile of ash so he could extract the thorium-232. Next, David needed radium. He knew radium was used in the paint on the faces of clocks, automobiles, and airplane instrument panels until the late 1960s. So he began visiting junkyards and antique stores in search of radium-coated dashboard panels or clocks. Once he had enough, David secured a sample of barium sulfate from the X-ray ward at a local hospital and used it to concentrate the radium. Now 17, he made significant progress, and David planned to build a model breeder reactor, but he needed at least 30 pounds of enriched uranium to sustain a chain reaction. He was determined to get as far as he could by trying to get his various radioisotopes to interact with one another. David said, no matter what happened, there would be something changing into something, some kind of action going on there. He monitored his mini reactor at the Golf Manor Laboratory with his Geiger counter. The level of radiation after a few weeks was far greater than it was at the time of assembly. I know I transformed some radioactive materials. Even though there was no critical pile, I know that some of the reactions that go on in a breeder reactor went on to a minute extent, he said. It was 2:40 a.m. on August 31st, 1994, when the Clinton Township Police responded to a call concerning a young man who had been spotted in a residential neighborhood apparently stealing tires from a car. When they caught up with David, they discovered over 50 foil-wrapped cubes of mysterious gray powder in the trunk of his car. Small discs and cylindrical metal objects, lantern mantles, mercury switches, a clock face, ores, fireworks, vacuum tubes, and assorted chemicals and acids. The police must have been baffled. They called in the Michigan State Police Bomb Squad to examine David's car and the State Department of Public Health, or DPH, to supply radiological assistance. State radiological experts found aluminum pie pans, jars of acids, Pyrex cups, milk crates, and other materials strewn about in David's makeshift shed laboratory, much of it contaminated with excessive levels of radioactive material, especially americium-241 and thorium-232. How high, you're wondering? A vegetable can, for example, registered at 50,000 counts per minute, which is about 1,000 times higher than normal levels of background radiation. After determining that no radioactive materials had leaked outside the shed, state authorities sealed it and petitioned the federal government for help. Unfortunately, David went into a serious depression after his laboratory was shut down. Years of painstaking work had been thrown in the garbage or buried deep underground. Students at Chippewa Valley had taken to calling him Radioactive Boy, and when his girlfriend Heather sent David Valentine's balloons at his high school, they were seized by the principal, who apparently feared they had been inflated with chemical gases David needed to continue his experiments. David had hoped to pursue a career as a nuclear specialist, but he ended up enlisting in the Navy. EPA scientists believe his life expectancy may have been greatly shortened by his exposure to radioactivity, particularly since he spent large amounts of time in the small enclosed shed with large amounts of radioactive material. David died on Tuesday, September 27, 2016, at the age of 39. His father confirmed that the cause of death was not from radiation exposure, but alcohol poisoning. And while we can't help you build your own power plant, we can suggest taking interesting classes over at Skillshare. This week, we've been loving a class called Pixel Art Fundamentals: Create Pixel Art for Games. By the end of this class, at the very least, you'll have your own character and background to start prototyping your own games. Skillshare is an online learning community with over 20,000 classes in management, marketing, UI UX design, and more. The first 1,000 people to sign up by visiting skillshare.com/infographics32 or by clicking the link in the description will receive 2 months of Skillshare absolutely free. Join Skillshare and start learning today. So, Do you know other crazy stories of young scientists creating their own labs and experiments? Let us know in the comments. Also, be sure to check out our other video called Atomic Bomb versus Hydrogen Bomb. Thanks for watching, and as always, don't forget to like, share, and subscribe. See you next time.